calm and reasoned way, so if you hear a view which you disagree with, just don't shout and get angry. Just wait till the end and ask a polite question to Dave or Richard and try and express why you disagree with that nicely. So I would like to welcome our speakers. So we have Professor Richard Norman, retired philosophy professor from Kent. He's also a member of the East Kent Humanist Society and the British Society of Humanists. Over to talking about. On my left, we have Sir David Workman. He's very interested in theology and English language. He has a background teaching it. And he's also part of the International Christian Education Ministry. So he knows his creation stuff. So we're going to have 20 minutes of talking from each side, and then we'll open the field to questions. So welcome Professor Richard Norman, please.
Thanks, Chris. Thanks very much for agreeing to chair it. And then we can go to the slideshow. And thanks very much to Dave for actually suggesting this event and being willing to debate. And I very much echo what Chris said, that however strongly we disagree, it's very important to debate those disagreements and to do so in as rational a way as possible and in a way that goes beyond just throwing abuse at people, and I hope we can have a calm and sensible and rational discussion this evening. So the debate is billed as evolution versus creation, and I take the word creation there to be shorthand for creationism in the sense of the literal understanding of the creation story at the beginning of the Judeo-Christian Bible. The first few verses of the first chapter of the book of Genesis. If that's not the position that Dave is going to be defending, then no doubt he will say so, but that's what I'm assuming. So let's have a look at what is said in those first few verses of the book of Genesis. You remember, six-day creation is described there, but on the first day God created the heaven and the earth, light and darkness, day and night. On day two, God separated the water and sky. On day three, God created dry land and the first living things, trees and other plants. Then on day four, he created the sun, moon, and stars. On day five, created sea creatures, fish and whales and so forth, and birds. And finally, on day six, he created land animals and the culmination of the creation of man. And then on the seventh day, of course, God rested. Now, notice immediately that if we take that literally, it's not just incompatible with the Darwinian theory of evolution. If you take it literally, you've got to reject the whole of modern science. You've got to take seriously, for example, the idea that there was such a thing as day and night before there was a sun. You've got to take seriously the idea that there was an earth before there was a sun for it to be a planet of and to revolve around. So you've got to reject the whole of modern astronomy, and with that, therefore, the whole of modern physics, as well as the whole of evolutionary theory. Now, in saying that, I'm not just trying to make a rhetorical point. The serious point here, the important point here, is that to look at the case for Darwinian evolutionary theory, you need to look at the way in which it is set firmly within the much wider story of scientific progress. So let's just remind ourselves of some key points in that historical process. This is going to be a bit of a cook's tour, but let's, a convenient point to start, given what I was just saying about six-day creationism, convenient point to start, obviously, is the first, in modern times, the first formulation of the heliocentric theory of the planetary system. Until Copernicus in 1530, most people had accepted the so-called Ptolemaic theory, inherited from the ancient world, that the Earth is at the center of the universe, and the sun, moon, and stars revolve around the Earth, and that leaves, of course, the problem of the movements of the planets, which seem to go all over the place from that point of view. That's what I've ever called planets. It's the Greek for wandering. And Copernicus's heliocentric theory made it much more possible to make sense of the movements of the planets if you recognize that they, like the Earth, are revolving around the Sun. And that's what then enabled Kepler, around 1600, to formulate laws of planetary motion, which explained why the Earth and the planets followed the courses that they did. Also in the 17th century, Galileo, of course, was a famous proponent of the Copernican theory and fell foul of the Catholic Church for being so. But of course, what Galileo was also interested in was the science of dynamics more generally, the movement of bodies in general, in particular projectiles. He was interested in the theories of ballistics, you know, why a cannonball moves in the way that it does, which couldn't be explained in terms of the Aristotelian physics which the church had inherited. So what's important about Galileo is that he's linking certain hypotheses about the movements of the heavenly bodies with theories about the nature of physical bodies generally, and it's that development that's then taken to its great culmination by Newton in the late 17th century with his theory of mechanics, a theory of motion in his famous Principia, which brings under the same laws all terrestrial motions and astronomical motions as well. And that's a crucially important breakthrough. I mean, prior to the 17th century, again inherited from Aristotle, was the idea that the movements of the heavens, the heavenly bodies, the sun, moon, and stars, had to be explained in quite different terms from the movement of physical objects on Earth. So what Newton offered was a way of bringing all of that under a single comprehensive theory of motion. And that then, towards the end of the 18th century, led people to start formulating theories about the origin of our Earth and the origin of our own solar system. For example, in terms of the idea of they're coming from a stellar nebula, but the availability of a science that incorporated the whole of physical motion rather than separating off the movements of the heavenly bodies and seeing them just as something eternal. Those developments in science made it possible and plausible to formulate theories about the origins of the Earth and the solar system for the first time, seeing them as having a history. That's the crucial point, not just eternal motions as had been previously supposed. Now, that growing interest in the history of the Earth is reflected also in the 18th century in a growing interest in fossils, although people didn't know quite what to make of them, but that also in the context of a growing interest in geology, and that comes to its culmination in the great work of geology by the geologist Charles Lyell, published in 1830. And the key feature of Lyell's approach to geology, it was a massive work, The Principles of Geology, in three volumes, I think. His key principle was what came to be labeled uniformitarianism, which is a bit of a mouthful, but the key point there, again, parallel to what I was saying about Newton, is his hypothesis was that the formation of the Earth can be explained in terms of a continuous process involving the kinds of physical phenomena that we're familiar with today. You don't need to suppose catastrophic external interventions to explain how the Earth's surface and the different geological strata came to be as they are, provided you recognize the huge timescale during which these things happen. You can explain all the geological phenomena and all the geological strata, the different kinds of rocks and the different levels that they are, and the formation of mountains and valleys and so on. You can explain all of that in terms of the kinds of phenomena that we know still take place, the kinds of physical phenomena that we can observe and that we can understand and can measure, things like earthquakes and volcanoes, glacial movements, the erosion created by rivers and so on. The hypothesis of uniformitarianism plus the hypothesis of processes going on for many millions of years makes it possible for the first time to give credible explanations of geological phenomena. Now, it's against that background then that we need to look at the emergence of evolutionary theory in the 19th century. So you've got Lyell's geology in place, and Lyell was a huge influence on Darwin when Darwin went on his trip around the world in HMS Beagle. He took with him copies of Lyell, and he was in personal correspondence with him. And the crucial thing that Lyell brings to Darwin's biology is that recognition of the Earth as being millions and indeed billions of years old. Darwin was aware also of the fossil evidence, the evidence connected with, against that, in the context of that geological background, that living things have existed for millions of years, and that if you look at the relationship between the fossils and the geological strata, you can see that the simplest organisms are the oldest at the lowest geological layers, and that they're species that existed in the past that are now extinct. But because that by itself, the geological context and the fossil evidence, leaves open the question of whether those different species came into existence or became extinct by a continuous process of evolution or through separate creation. Lyell himself didn't, or was very skeptical about the idea of evolution. And this ideas of evolution were in the air prior to Darwin. But Lyell thought that the fossil evidence, even within the context of his geological theories, was compatible with the idea of separate creation for different species in different geological eras. People like Lamarck were tentatively trying to formulate theories of evolution, but the crucial problem that they had to grapple with was how could one species have evolved into another? Now, the key point about Darwin then is not that he was the first to develop a theory of evolution. The key point about Darwin was that what he did was to come up with a mechanism for how one species could evolve into another. And Darwin took his clue from the phenomenon of domestic breeding. Darwin was particularly interested in pigeons and pigeon fanciers. He was always exchanging letters with pigeon fanciers about how they bred their pigeons, but I couldn't find any nice pictures of pigeons, so I went for dogs. We might ask ourselves, how could all these different creatures, I mean, compare the poodle with the Great Dane or the St. Bernard or whatever, how could all these different breeds have come, as we know they did, from the same single origin of the original wild dogs? And the answer to that question is that what dog breeders do is to take advantage of natural variations that occur within dogs, as within any species, and they select for particular variations that they want to make use of for hunting or for being cuddly or whatever. And through that combination of natural variations plus selection, breeders can breed very, very different breeds of dogs. You might think it's amazing how you could get such variety of dogs, when the answer is simply natural variation coupled with a process of selection. Now, what Darwin did, this is the key point about Darwinian theory, it's not just the fossil evidence, it's how to interpret it. And Darwin interpreted it in terms of an analogy between what he called domestic selection, what dog breeders and pigeon fanciers and so on do, and natural selection. That's the key concept that Darwin introduced, not the concept of evolution, but the concept of natural selection as the mechanism of evolution. So like, as with domestic breeding, he's building on the recognition that variations occur in nature, in all species. There's always small variations from one generation to another in any species. What's the equivalent to domestic selection, selection of particular features, particular characteristics? Well, Darwin recognized that this can be found in the fact of what he called the struggle for existence. He was very much influenced by the population theories of Malthus here, Thomas Malthus, an English clergyman. The phrase, the struggle for existence, refers to the fact that in any species, Far more individuals are born than can survive. The reproduction rate in any species produce many more than can possibly survive in any particular environment. So there's always a struggle for existence in which those best adapted to survive in that environment do so. That's the notion of the survival of the fittest. Fittest doesn't then mean physically fit or any particular notion of fitness. Fitness simply means ability to survive in a certain kind of environment. So given the fact that there is a struggle for existence, those natural variations that confer even a slight advantage in the struggle for existence will tend to be perpetuated. So that's the concept of natural selection, which Darwin takes to be analogous to domestic selection. If you couple the phenomenon of natural variation and the struggle for existence of natural selection with the hypothesis of this happening over immensely long periods of time, then you can see how, just as domestic breeders using domestic selection can produce radically different breeds within a simple species, so over millions and billions of years, the analogous process of natural selection can produce new varieties which eventually become new subspecies and eventually new species. So that's the key point then about Darwin's breakthrough. It's not that he had a theory of evolution, it's that he recognized the concept of natural selection as the vehicle of evolution. Hence the title of his work. People refer to it as The Origin of Species. It's important to look at the full title, On the Origin of Species by Means of Natural Selection. That was the theory that he put forward. The full title, which I can't read very well actually, but maybe you can read it better up there. Or the preservation of favoured races in the struggle for life. So again, there's that notion of the struggle for existence, which gives rise to the process of natural selection, which is the vehicle for evolution, the vehicle by which variations can be perpetuated when they confer an advantage in the struggle for existence. So that's Darwin's key breakthrough. An important point is to see it within that historical context of the progress of science, which I mentioned earlier. And that progress continues further, of course. The problem that Darwin was still left with is how these selected characteristics could be passed on. Why didn't you just get reversion to type? Even if a particular variation conferred a particular advantage for in the struggle for survival in a particular environment, why didn't the process of reproduction just, as it were, neutralize it when that individual mated with another individual that didn't have that characteristic? Why did characteristics get perpetuated and passed on from one individual to another? And it was Mendel's discoveries in genetics, the formulation of gene theory, that provided filled in that gap by showing how genetics doesn't just involve an amalgam of features inherited from two parents, but involves selection of one or another chromosome from genetic structures of the two different parents. And of course, the Mendelian genetics has developed into the incredibly complex modern scientific understanding of genetics, a key stage in which, of course, was the discovery by Francis Crick and what's his collaborator?
Watson and Crick.
In the 1950s, I think it was, when they discovered the structure of DNA, the double helix, and the developments of genetics since then, which have been massive, of course, have made it possible to understand in much more detail how particular mutations, natural variations, can produce new varieties and over long periods of time, new species. And DNA sequencing now makes it possible to establish at that level the relations between different species and to track their evolutionary relationships and the evolutionary process. So what people now call neo-Darwinism is really the synthesis of Darwinian theory of natural selection and modern genetics, and all that adds up to an incredibly powerful theory which can understand all the mechanisms of selection and evolution. Neo-Darwinism, in turn, is nested within everything that we know now from a cosmological point of view about the universe as a whole. The Doppler effect has provided evidence that we live in an expanding universe, and if you, as it were, track back that process of expansion, you can hypothesize that the universe is roughly 14 billion years old, and what people talk about was the Big Bang, which wasn't a bang, of course, but just the original singularity from which the expansion created the expanding, the beginning of the expanding universe in which we now live. So neo-Darwinism is nested within then that cosmological theory of the origins of the universe as a whole. In terms of that cosmological theory, the recognition that our sun and our Earth and its other planets were formed probably about 4.5 billion years ago, and then into that you can place what we know about the origins of life on our own planet. The first microscopic life about 3.5 billion years ago, first land animal 400 million years ago, beginnings of our hominid ancestors 3 to 4 million years ago. Modern humans evolved quite recently, about 130,000 years ago. Now, what I've been stressing then is the way in which Darwinian evolutionary theory is nested within that much wider context of all those different branches of science, geology, cosmology, mechanics, genetics, and so on. I need to finish about 7 o'clock to keep on time. So it's not just a question of looking at the details of the fossil evidence. It's a question of looking at evolutionary theory as an integral part of modern science. And this really brings me back to what I was saying at the beginning, you can't just pick or choose, you can't just assess evolutionary theory by reference to particular bits of evidence considered in a piecemeal fashion. You need to recognize how Darwinian evolutionary theory fits into our understanding of the universe as a whole. If you reject it, you have to reject the whole of modern science. You have to reject everything that we know about the universe, everything that we know about geology, everything that we know about the relationship between astronomical movements and mechanical movements of things on Earth. You really have to reject the whole business of scientific inquiry. Why do people do so? This will be my last point. Why do people do so? Because, I would say, of a misunderstanding about the nature of religious texts. As far as I know, what regularly prompts people to reject evolutionary theory and to defend some kind of New Earth creationism is always a reference to whatever is claimed about the evidence. It's always, in the end, based on an allegiance to a particular religious text. Now, just bear in mind here that every culture has its own creation myths. How do you decide which creation myth, which religious story is the one that you go for? You do so for cultural reasons. Even if you do so because of your own allegiance to the Christian tradition and Christian culture, you've still got a choice of which creation story you go for. Do you go for the one in Genesis chapter 1, or do you go for the one in Genesis chapter 2, which is very different, which has human beings created before plants and animals are created, for example, which are created to keep man company, and then woman is created later on after that. So you've got a big, so even there, even within the book of Genesis, you've got a choice of different creation myths. And the reason why that's so is because what they're offering is not a scientific account. Now, it's not my job as a humanist and atheist to tell religious people how to read religious texts, but I'm going to, because it's a misunderstanding of religious texts to take them out of their historical context and treat them as though they were claims to modern science. They're stories, and they're incredibly powerful stories, the story of the fall and of Adam and Eve and human beings' self-consciousness in chapter 2 of Genesis is a wonderfully powerful story which throws a lot of light on and is incredibly perceptive about the human condition and what it is to be human, but it's not a scientific account of the origins of the universe and the origin of species. Chapter 1 of Genesis isn't a scientific account either, and it's a mistake to treat them as such.
But I'm going to end there, and I suspect that you'll get a very different view now from that of Romney, so I'm going to do. Thank you.
Well, whether you're here purely by chance or you designed to be here, it's great that you could, make it. Right. Been said, and I quote, maths, science, history. Unraveling the mystery, it all started with a Big Bang. Now, whether Sheldon and Penny could have come from a big explosion like that, I seriously don't think so. I question the logic of the Big Bang, the expansion, whatever you like to call it. I don't think it's scientific, I think it's science fiction. But first of all, I'd like to define a few terms. And first of all, I'll say what I don't believe, very briefly say what I don't believe, and then I'll say what I do believe. Evolution. What is evolution? You have cosmic evolution, chemical evolution, organic evolution, macro and micro. Cosmic, chemical, organic, and macro. I don't believe it's scientific. I don't believe in it. I don't think it's credible. I don't think it adds up. But micro, if you'd like to call it evolution, then yes. So the whole universe started with a Big Bang. I lived in the Middle East, so I've got about 28 minutes. I lived in the Middle East for a few years and experienced a few. There were a few explosions nearby. You can call them massive expansions, but I would call them explosions. And they tended to destroy life rather than create. Semi believe in cosmic evolution and the other evolutions, well, all of the evolutions, but I changed my mind. I looked at the evidence on the other side of the story. Did everything begin from an infinitesimally small singularity, or thing, as many scientists call it, thing, because they don't know actually what it is? This big ball that we are now sat on, 6 million billion ton ball spinning around in space, did that come from something smaller than a full stop at the end of a sentence? Again, I question the logic of that. Macroevolution. Do I believe that random mutations will result in changes from one genus, one kind? Kind is mentioned in the Bible. This is the same as the genus, the biological term genus. Do I believe that it's changed from one genus to another, random mutations over whatever time you like to give it? Then no, I don't. It needs lateral jumps. Within the genome, you need lateral. You can have mutations with divergences and very rarely they can help, but you actually need a sort of miraculous jump to gain information. You need to gain information for macroevolution. What's it all about? We suddenly ask through history. Okay. That's a bit of an exaggeration there. No cousin of mine. Frog to a prince. Can a frog, you call it a frogosaurus if you like, can that turn into a prince? I don't believe so. Microevolution. We had the dogs earlier on. So adaptation within species, that's observable and testable. If it's good science, it's got to be observable and testable. I like good science. Anything else is science fiction. adaptation within species is observable. We have the finches, big finches, the small big finches, we have the apes, we have the baboons, the gibbons, the orangutans, etc. They tend to breed within species. Canine dogs. We actually have a home, a cross between a Labrador and a Husky, a Labrusky. Dogs will mate with dogs, and they will always, it's always observable and testable, but they always tend to be dogs. Okay. What do I believe in? Intelligent design. I believe that the creation has a creator. I believe that the design has a designer, that all life has a life source. Intelligence comes from superintelligence. To say that a computer will come from non-intelligence, I don't think that's an intelligent sentence. Engineering, the DNA, has an engineer. We now know that the DNA structure is so complex, so incredible, that actually it has to have an engineer. Okay, define a little bit of terminology here. Intelligent design. The proponents, those who believe in intelligent design, they're not necessarily creationists. The creationist believes in a personal creator. I've got a list of. I've got a list of professors, those who have hold PhDs, and they would hold to the intelligent design. Here, here's a brief little example of those who would believe that there's an intelligent designer. John Watson, professor of reactive chemistry, PhD from the University of St. Andrews. Russell Carlson, professor of biochemistry and molecular biology. Alexander Puga, astrophysicist. Ralph Selig, professor of molecular and cellular biology. Michael Bay, professor of biological science. Domingo Eridan, professor of geology. You get the idea. There's a list of 800 PhD doctors, professors who have signed up to the descentfromdarwinism.org statement of belief, that they are very skeptical that random mutations will create new kinds of species. They don't believe in Darwinism or neo-Darwinism. You may have heard of Professor David Belinsky, Professor Stephen Myers, the Cambridge graduate and geophysicist. He would hold to that view. Do I believe that everywhere and everything and everybody has come from nowhere, nothing and nobody? No, I don't. What is the cause? It's intelligent design. What is the effect? Us. I don't believe it's logical or scientific to believe that hydrogen will, given time, as long as you like, millions of years, billions of years, zillions of years, that will turn into a human. Hydrogen to human? No. Bacteria to brain surgeon? No. Molecule to man? Rock to rocket scientist? Frog to a prince? Frogosaurus to a prince? Inanimate to animate? A big leap of faith. Singularity to rationality, asexual reproduction to sexual reproduction. Maths, Pythagoras said, if you want to know whether there's an intelligent designer, a creator, look at maths. Look at the cohesion, the symmetry, and the order. It's undeniable. Okay. Here's four of the 1,000 scientists who signed up to the intelligent design belief. They're the ones brave enough to put their names on the actual website. Okay, I'm going to be honest with you now, and hopefully very specific, and tell you what this. Sorry, forgot about this one. This is Einstein, who also believed that there had to be some sort of form of intelligence that created everything. So, what do I believe? I'll be very specific. I believe in intelligent design. More specific, I believe in a creator. More specific, I believe he is called God. Which God? The only feasible one, the only historical one, the only accurate one, the one that stands up to the test, is the God of the Bible. The God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, King David, Moses, etc. I'll be more specific. I need to be specific and accurate and honest. The Word. It was the Word. The Bible says it time and time again that it was actually God spoke things into existence. Let there be light. It's incredible, but I believe it's credible. You have on the one hand the origin of species, and you have on the other hand Genesis, which means origins, Hebrew Bereshit. Why is it credible and feasible? Because I believe it makes sense. It adds up. Okay. It says in the Bible that the Word became flesh, became a human. This creator, the Bible's claim that this creator actually became a human. So obviously this person is Jesus Christ. This is we get our date from when he was born. And he actually became a human. This is, I'm being honest with what the creation story is, in a nutshell, taken to its logical conclusion. Okay, this person, is he cowardly, foolish, and arrogant, or is he the opposite? Is he courageous, wise, and humble? What sort of person do you trust? I believe he was courageous, wise, and humble. Now, he made some major claims. This creator, this Word, this Jesus person, claimed, I am the Father, are one. He claimed to be God. Before Abraham was, I am. I am the resurrection and the life. It says, in Colossians, the image of the invisible God, by him all things were created, by his word. God has spoken to us by his Son, by whom he made all the cosmos, who is the express image of his person. So I'm just being very honest and detailed here about what the Bible claims. So we have a choice. We have a choice. Which story are we to believe? Okay, if we're going to be logical and honest, we need to read the creation claims. The evidence to substantiate the claims. Okay, would you like a little bit of evidence to substantiate the claims written in the Bible? I believe this is irrefutable proof. I believe this account is reliable and trustworthy and accurate. He claimed to be the Messiah. Well, he fulfilled 60 separate prophecies. There are 60 separate prophecies written about this supposed creator who was to come into the Middle East and live. Born of the tribe of Judah, descended from the royal line of David, born in Bethlehem, lived in Nazareth, worked in Capernaum, buried in a rich man's tomb, etc. There were 60. This is miraculous. Now, these are prophecies, and I realize that atheism is a non-profit organization, so you may not go for that. But there are other written prophecies in the Bible. There are actually hundreds. Daniel writes about the Babylonian, Medo-Persian, Greek, and Roman world empires before, this is 600 BC, before they actually happened. He wrote those that these world dominant kingdoms would actually be around. This is the prophecy. So this is the miraculous basis of the Bible. Because on the one hand you have the origin of species, which is a natural process, as Richard just explained, this natural over millions and billions of years. Or you have the supernatural in the Bible. Is it a supernatural book? Prophecies, I believe that's a supernatural piece of evidence. Okay. Moving on. Here's another piece of evidence. I believe this here proves the Creator in the writing, that the Word became flesh. Here you have in the original Hebrew, Bereshit bara Elohim et ha-shamayim ve-et ha-aretz. And within that, 10-word sentence in Hebrew. You have the five core elements of all science and all life. Bereshit, in the beginning, time. Bara, creating, energy. Elohim, power source. The heavens, space, the earth, matter. Incidentally, Elohim, you have Father, Son, and Spirit of God, because Im, the Yod and the Mem at the end, makes it plural. So there you have the one unit at the beginning. Okay, picking up on the dates, let's move on to this. How long have I got? 10 minutes. Fly through this. Do I believe in literal days? 100% yes. The Bible is very clear, the Creator book is very clear that it is a real literal day. A yom, every time, and it's used hundreds of times, every time the word yom is used in this book, and alongside it you have a number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7, etc., it's always a literal day. It said, in the evening and the morning was the first day. Erev ve'boker. Erev ve'boker is a day. Has to be, evening and the morning. And on day six, Yom, God saw all that he'd made, and it was tov me'od. No cancer, no toothache, no headache, no heartache. It was all tov me'od. It wasn't perfect. Perfection is in heaven. Okay, apart from the Bible, is there anything? Well, I believe love, the existence of this invisible connection between two people, this incredible relational, invisible connection, is a proof that there is a God, and loving at that. Here we have two people that probably love each other, I don't know. Hopefully they've been faithful all their life and they've loved each other, and there they are, love. A few other things. The soul, we have a soul. I don't know whether you like soul music, but I like a little bit of Stevie Wonder myself. It hits the soul, this invisible part of you that I believe is a proof that there is a supernatural life giver. We have a heart, we have a soul. Justice. Can justice come from a molten rock, which this earth supposedly was at one point? Can creativity, a beauty, order out of chaos? Friendship. You might be surprised to know that I actually believe that one key proof that evolution is not true, micro, natural selection within species, it's observable, I'm not talking about that, the other evolutions, is pain and suffering and heartache. If you believe in evolution, what's the problem? It's been happening for millions and millions of years. All of a sudden, you care? That doesn't seem to add up. As a creationist, as a Bible-believing creationist, I can see that that's part of the fall. When Adam and Eve took of the fruit, they enjoyed their apples and bananas and whatever. It was a sumptuous fruit that they fell for. Okay, we have a heart, we have a mind, we have a soul, we have an imagination. How sad that we would tell our children and they lived happily ever after. What an evil concept. If evolution is true, we shouldn't be lying to our children and tell them these stories. In the creation book, in the Bible, it says that God has put eternity in our hearts. We have this concept of eternity, a happy ever after. If that's a result of the Big Bang, cosmic evolution, then not so good. Music. Proof, I believe, that since creation, our Creator has created us to be created. Okay. The massive variety within species. Symbiosis. So we have these species that are dependent on it. Which came first? Symbiosis. There's another proof that everything was made in a mature way, with all the creatures there interlinked. We have just the right oxygen level, gets into the blood, gets into our cells, the cells. We have hundreds of thousands of cells. I think I may have this on the edge. DNA double helix. Some people say that DNA stands for design, not accident.
It's true.
Deoxyribonucleic acid. Phenomenal. Cells. 60 to 100 trillion cells in the body. And each cell has trillions, about hundreds of trillions of atoms within each cell. Incredible. 1 meter of DNA, Earth is 150 million, you may know this, 150 million kilometers from the sun. DNA is stretched end to end, reaches the sun, back 300 times. Proof of an incredible designer, I believe. Okay, which is the myth, which is the fact? In conclusion, I would just say this. Do you have the courage to look at both sides? Or are you blinking? You've come to the debate, that's fantastic, but deep down, are you real? I've looked at both sides. I've looked at other creation, I've read the Bhagavad Gita, read the Quran, I've looked around, been around, and I've made up my mind. If you're a good scientist, you'll look at both sides of the story. If you're a, I would say a level-headed human being, you'll look at both sides honestly as well. Truth can be a bitter pill to swallow. Or you can take the red pill. In conclusion, just say we've got various leaflets written by professors and PhD scientists on every single strand of science, and it may answer your questions. We've got DVDs and a couple of books as well. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much to both of you. It's interesting to see two very different arguments, but the similar analogy with the dogs can be interpreted differently. I suppose now the main job is in your hands, because we can open the field up to any questions that you might have for either of the two speakers. So if you do have a question, please tell me which speaker to address it to, and then we'll see your question.
I'd like to ask a question, David. The main burden of his way he was arguing seemed to be the argument from incredulity. Most of it, a lot of times you were saying, well, I can't really believe that, that doesn't add up, and so on. And I agree with you, absolutely. I think Darwinism's incredible. But I also think that belief in a benevolent God who created the world is also incredible. I mean, the idea that a mind should come out of nowhere, you already said, is incredible. Well, so, you know, the charged question, where does God come from? So I think both sides are incredible, which cancel each other out. So we have to start and ask the question, what actually happened? And you haven't actually answered that. All you've actually told us over and over again is that you find it incredible. And we all agree, both sides are incredible. So what's your argument? That's what I'd like to sort of push back to you.
So what I did mention that, maybe not specifically enough, I believe that, is the sound okay? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
what I actually believe is this supernatural creator has created everything by his word in 6 days. And on the seventh day, he ceased working, the original Hebrew. In Hebrew, you have to take, it's a very contextual language. You have to understand the context of the Hebrew. And he ceased working on the seventh day. Sorry, there was another point that you made there. What's the other point?
I was referring to Dawkins' argument about how can there be, if you're arguing that the minds can't come from, you can't get complexity out of something very simple like just a dot, the Big Bang, but you're actually arguing that yourself when you say that God, who is a complex being, pre-existing creation.
Yeah, 100% I am. That's where I stand.
But it's argument by assertion, isn't it?
Yeah, and the question, where did God come from? Well, it's very, if you're going to be honest with what it actually says in the creation book in Genesis, in Bereshit, he's outside of time. He created time like a time bubble. He's now actually in time with us, but he's actually outside of time, and he created us with a choice, distinct from animals. The animals just live by instinct, but we can step outside of our instinct and we can make genuine choices. And some of those choices are good, some of them are bad. But the Bible is very clear that that is our responsibility. It's not just our pure instinct, and it's sin. I did have it on the slide, but I skipped it. But this person in the Creator God, in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, he very specifically, in time, 2013 years ago, came to this planet, claimed to be God, claimed to be there to show people the truth, but also to die, to take the punishment for sin. He said that he's very honest, very, very specific, and for three years he had Pharisees and Sadducees criticizing him and around him the whole time. Not so pleasant for 3 years, but there we are. And they couldn't find any fault in him. He died for our sin. He came back from the dead. Again, it's miraculous from beginning to end. I'm not trying to get away from the supernatural. It's from Genesis to Revelation, you've got supernatural. But I believe your heart and your soul and your choice comes from a supernatural source. To create, for something to just live purely by instinct, say bacteria into a baboon, I still don't believe that, but okay, if that's possible, but to move on from there, to actually have a genuine choice, that's beyond the natural, the choice that we have.
My question is to Professor Norman. I've got a book here by Michael Behe, you're probably aware of Michael Behe. Mm-hmm. It's called Darwin's Black Box. Mm-hmm. You've read it, it's a good read. But the point he's making in Darwin's Black Box is that the cell, from which, and you're aware that Darwin said that everything came from a simple self-replicating cell. That everything, it was at the bottom of the tree, and then from this tree, all these different things, all these different creatures, what it came. But it came from a simple self-replicating cell. Now, Michael Behe's point, and the name of the book itself, which is Darwin's Black Book, he couldn't actually look into the cell because he didn't have the technology. I mean, the theory of evolution is very much a sort of 19th century belief system, 19th century science. He couldn't look into it. So therefore, you know, Michael Behe said this is a black box in which he couldn't look into it. Darwin and Haeckel, his contemporary, made a wild stab at it. And they said they thought it was a simple cell. And this, of course, would accord with their idea that it could evolve. It had to be a simple cell. But now modern science, 21st century science, in fact, as you know, Crick and Watson, the whole DNA, we now see inside the cell, and it is phenomenally complex. So therefore, the question really is in the hands of the evolutionist to give an explanation as to how such a cell came about by pure chance. And the issue is, and the main woof and the warp of Michael's book, is it simply hasn't. And I'll just read a very short statement he says here. He says this, molecular evolution has never addressed the question of how complex structures came to be. In effect, the theory of Darwinian molecular evolution has not published, so it should perish. DNA sort of language. Remember, this simple cell is not simple at all. It's a strand of information. It is a language. Not only is it a language, it has a machine to read the language. And this machine itself then has to, there are machines that actually
find it. I hate to be rude.
I'll finish there. The point is that it is very complex and there's no explanation to its beginning.
I'm glad you mentioned Bayer because it doesn't even mean to make a point picking up something that Dave said. Don't forget Bayer and other proponents of what's been called the intelligent design position are not six-day creationists. And one thing I'd like to, I think Dave will agree with me here, there's an important distinction between intelligent design theory of people like Bayer and literal six-day creationism. Bayer doesn't reject the notion of evolution over a very, very long period of time, over billions of years. What Bayer claims is that that evolutionary process can't be explained purely in terms of random mutation and natural selection. Of course, that's a very different claim from the defense of six-day creationism. Now, as you say, what Bayer appeals to is the notion of complexity. In particular, the phrase that Bayer uses is irreducible complexity. It's not just the example of the cell. He takes various phenomena. He says, these are complex phenomena. How could they have evolved through a very, very gradual process of bit by bit? I mean, the standard example, favorite example, which Darwin himself responded to, is the example of the eye. And early critics of Darwin said, well, how could the eye have evolved from something that was, just by very, very slow steps? What use would be a tiny bit of an eye? What use would be a pupil but no retina, or whatever? But of course, that's not the evolutionary story that you tell. The evolutionary process by which the eye gradually developed through different species wasn't, first of all, little bits of an eye. It would have had its origin in just very, very basic light-sensitive tissue, which gradually became more complex. But the problem really here is you to sort of set up a notion of complexity and then to just say, oh, well, it can't have come about gradually, is to fail to take seriously the business of spelling out the detailed steps over an incredibly long period. Now, the other point to make, I think, is, of course, that complexity is relative to the particular entity that we're talking about. You say that the cell is a complex phenomenon. How could it have come out of something more simple? But, of course, matter itself is an incredibly complex phenomenon. We now know that the atom, which was thought to be in 19th century science the fundamental unit of matter, is far more complex than people thought. Modern physics tells an incredibly complex story about subatomic particles and so on. So the components of the cell will, at another level themselves, be incredibly complex. You can't just sort of set up this simple dichotomy of complex and simple, and then say, and how could the complex have come out of something simple? It does relate, if I could just very quickly, relates to that last point about the appeal to incredulity, which again seemed to take the form of saying, here's something complex, here's something very simple, how could the complex have come out of the simple? How could a human have come out of hydrogen? How can a prince come out of a frog, or whatever? But of course, what we're talking about is not sudden leaps from one end of the spectrum to the other. What you always have to look at in all these cases of the emergence of complexity is the incredibly long and slow, bit-by-bit process by which that complexity develops. Okay, I think there's nothing else.
Could I just say, just briefly? So, therefore, we need to have not billions, we need to have trillions of transitional links between a frog and a prince, between a sort of a guinea pig type thing and a whale. There should be trillions of trans. We should find that in the fossil record, and that is lacking. I was working in South Africa, went to a safari park, and they had a full-size picture of an elephant on the wall, and the I think there are about 15 different main stages that they show, all the way from that, from the elephant, all the way down to this sort of guinea pig type of. I'd like to see the evidence. I'd like to see the genuine empirical evidence that they have of all these transitions. They shouldn't just have 10, they should have trillions of transitional forms, and they're not there. Irreducible complexity, just the vast irreducible complexity there. I agree. Within the DNA and the cell structure and the eye, Darwin said, I freely admit, to think that the eye has evolved seems absurd to the highest degree. And I would agree. It's irreducibly complex. You cannot reduce part of it and for it to work. Where are the transitional forms from a light sensor to an eye?
Gentlemen.
I don't fully understand all that, you know, I've really said in the complex way that they have. But in the simplicity of my own understanding is that you say that it really takes a long time, and you say it really happens dumb quick, supernatural.
That sums it up nicely.
My point is that at the age of 19, when I was wanting for attempted murder of a policeman, and I was on drugs, and I was violent, and I was brought up on cliché, kill or be killed, and take no prisoners, and I lived a very violent and wicked life. I robbed and stole, and done every kind of evil you can think of, and full of hatred and murder, and I've left people for dead until this day, God only knows. But supernaturally, one day, or one morning, in a hotel room, my life was changed. From that moment, the hatred, the murder, the drugs, the violence, everything went supernaturally, and I've never been the same since. And now I don't want to hate people, I love people, and even when people hate me, somehow I'm able to love them. Can you please, Richard, by any chance of a miracle, explain what happened to me if it was not Jesus Christ, the Son of God, by his grace and mercy, that turned an evil, wicked man like myself into a human being? Then what on earth happened to me, mate?
It's not for me to say, is it? I mean, if if you went through a life-changing experience, which you feel has, you know, given a huge value to your life, and enabled you to look back on your past life and to be immensely grateful that you have now changed, well, great. It's not for me to say how that happened, and it's not for me to make a judgment, but just to be pleased for you. All I can say is that there are all sorts of life-changing experiences that people have. Life-changing experiences that come from meeting people, life-changing experiences that come from being in very trying situations, and suddenly finding new reserves of energy. For many people, having a child is a life-changing experience. You know, I guess it's the most common one that there is. You know, that people live a fairly directionless life and perhaps a rather unsympathetic life towards other people. And then having a child brings you to recognize the value of that kind of human intimacy. It gives you a stake in the future. It gives you someone close to you to care for, and so on. That's another example of a life-changing experience. There are all sorts of life-changing experiences. Just to give you one other kind of example, people who found themselves in appalling political situations, like, for example, the Nazi death camps and so on. And the challenge of being in that situation, some people it crushes, other people it brings out incredible reserves of resilience and energy that they never knew that they had.
Interject, we're moving off the topic of evolution.
So was the question. I take your point, yeah. Let me just say, people have all sorts of life-changing experiences, and you don't need to appeal to the supernatural to explain.
Okay, yeah. I just want to just say one thing, if possible.
Move on to the next one. We're limited for time, so we can really get lots of
being gentlemen.
I've got a few questions today.
Could you limit them to just one?
many. Okay, I'll stick with one for now. Right. If you've acknowledged the existence of DNA as something that codes my body and has life, you can sequence the genome so you can see my DNA at base. And let's say you take a chimpanzee and you sequence its genome, and there's upwards of a 97% similarity in our. And then you do it with another primate, less related to me, but still within that family. And you keep going and going and going until you have basically a pattern of all life. And it follows, basically it follows. Creatures become less and less related as they go off into different groups. How do you explain the similarity of the DNA between me and the chimpanzee? If we were created, surely those similarities would be redundant. Surely you wouldn't need...
The quick answer is we have the same design. The designer could have made us out of plasticine, he could have made us out of rock, synthetic, he made us out of DNA. The difference between... And I'll try and answer the question. So that 3%, would you agree that that is phenomenal information, a phenomenal difference in that 3%? And would you agree that lettuce has 60% the same DNA as us? Would you say you're related to a lettuce, therefore, because a percentage? Or does the lettuce have DNA because then we can digest it? Because we have a very clever designer who made baboons and gibbons and orangutans made of DNA with eyes and ears and a mouth so they can eat and see and hear. Mentioned symbiosis. We've got the bees, we've got the flowers, we've got creatures made of DNA. Fantastic. If they weren't, we'd be in big trouble. But the 3%, would you agree that the 3% is a massive load of information?
Accounts for the differences between me and chimpanzee, yes.
No. You're wearing the danger of bringing this into a conversation. It's more of a question type thing. So, do you have a question?
Right. To Richard Norman, if I may, please. I don't know if you'd mind me just doing a little illustration of what I mean, but I'll come down the front if you don't mind me doing so. This is about DNA and selection. Right? I want to show you something.
How quick is this?
It's going to be quick, but I'm looking for some change or something because I found I haven't got much. Dave, you got some change?
No, only notes.
Literally, Chris, you got anything
there?
The chair. Chris.
Using judgment.
Yeah. While you're finding some change.
Okay, that's fine. Here's the change. A friend has lent me some change.
So right. Just a quick comment. I was hoping Richard might be able to comment on this.
Yeah, go ahead.
It's because
the gentleman
that's gone there. Okay. It was just to say that I think there needs to be a distinction made between someone who would be a Christian and that doesn't necessarily mean you can't believe in evolutionary theory, that you can't hold faith. I think there needs to be a distinction made between David here represents a particular faith community or a certain type of belief that isn't necessarily, and the Christian theology is actually a lot more complex than we are being presented.
Yeah. Absolutely, yeah, and I mean it's a bit of an irony that I'm put in the position of criticising creationism, because the vast majority of Christians have not been six-day creationists. I mean, you go right back to the early church fathers and so on. It's always been a very, very minority position within the Christian tradition. Thank you for pointing that out.
Right,
yeah.
Having required some change. So,
Chris, could I comment on the
chapter? Yeah. This is a point about the difference in selection that you described between dogs and the assumption that Darwin made that such selection can evolve new species. I'd like you please to take out their nickel-looking coin, sort of nickel-coloured coin.
Sorry?
I'd like to take out their coin that's sort of nickel-coloured.
Which is nickel?
Well, that's a nickel-coloured, is it?
Right, there you are.
So I'll be generous to start with. I'd like to take out the brass coin, or any brass coins. Okay. I'd like to take out the plastic coins. Mm-hmm. Are there any plastic coins there, sir?
No.
Right, so you cannot take out of here something that's not already in here, agree? Now, selection operates on that basis, on dogs and things.
This is a lecture.
I'm just asking the question, right? How do you explain, right, the introduction of new information? I could take these coins, I appreciate them. I'm trying to use that as
The notion of random mutation, that's what selection works on. And we know that random mutation happens. When we call it random mutation, of course, that doesn't mean it's uncaused. Obviously there are very, very slight changes in the DNA that are caused by things like background radiation. We know that they happen. We know that those variations happen because, as I was saying with the analogy with domestic selection, domestic selection picks on those, selects from those. Now, if you allow that there is such a thing as domestic selection, which dog breeders and people do, from random mutations, then it seems to me that makes it perfectly intelligible that natural selection should pick out the same things. When you ask what do they pick out, then of course they don't pick out something that isn't there, they pick out natural variations in just the same way that domestic selection does. Now of course, in a sense, natural selection is a metaphor, it's not someone doing the selecting. The point is that the struggle for existence operates in the same way as though it were a selection process. But what it selects from is exactly the same thing as what domestic selection does.
So can I follow that with just one minor question, right? Where these mutations, it's important, can you give me an example of mutations that specifically add information to the genome and can be selected from?
Right.
Okay. We perhaps just debate that later.
Sorry, could one comment from the chap who
questioned?
Different Christian communities. I think if you're going to say that you believe in a creator and you say you are a Christian, you will believe the Bible, I would say. Would you agree with that?
I would say that your literal interpretation of the Bible will be read as a positivist.
So you would pick and choose. Okay.
Now, scientific methodology.
Okay.
Unlike you, you don't pick and choose theological points.
Pick and choose. Okay. Now, we've got to be honest and we've got to be very specific about what it is to be a true Christian and a creationist. When Jesus said, when the creator, he is the word who became human, you would believe that?
Sorry? Thank you for having the conversation again. You have to ask the question.
Okay,
specifically.
I'll answer the question. One quote that you may not believe, but I believe. The creator, the Lord Jesus Christ, he said that the whole of scripture is the word of God. And one of the quotes is in Acts 10:43, he said, to him all the prophets give witness. To him, that's the Lord Jesus Christ, to him all the prophets give witness that through his name, Lord means creator. Whoever believes in him shall receive the forgiveness of sins. So Lord is the creator, master. Jesus is the savior from sins. He died on the cross for your sins. See, it's very specific, and Christ means Messiah. So to call yourself a Christian, you have to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Very specific. And God is able to communicate in a very specific way, and we need to read the Bible in context and honesty.
It seems to me that you believe that Scripture is knowable by reason, and I assume... Scripture is knowable by reason. You can read Scripture and understand it by the powers of your mind.
Yes.
Okay. Likewise, would you agree that the world is knowable by reason?
The world is knowable by reason.
You apply your mind to the world and learn things about it. Okay, so if God created both scripture and reason, why would the findings of our reason regarding scripture contradict the findings of our reason regarding the world?
The findings of our reason regarding the world, I mean, I mentioned the list of 1,000 professors. 1,000 professors who signed up to the descent from Darwinism, that they would believe that reason...
But not to six-day creationism.
Sorry?
Not to six-day creationism.
No, there is a percentage that do. So they would say, you look at the world, and what do you surmise? You surmise that we are different to baboons. Why? We have a choice. We think about a creator. We have this ability to love and this higher relational value. So I would say to look at the what you
your claim is then that baboons don't experience love.
Sorry?
Your claim is then that baboon mother does not experience anything similar to what we would in our own species term to be love.
A baboon has a soul. It has a personality. It has emotions. And it thinks. It has emotions and personality and it thinks. But it doesn't have a spirit, it doesn't have a heart. This is what the creation book, the Bible, says. It distinguishes us from the baboons and the orangutans and the gibbons by this and many other abilities.
In the Bible, originally, it talks about the world being a ball of gas and land was formed out of the sea was formed. But it took a day. So the world was created overnight. What in science would have taken millions of years, let's say, happened in a day. That's my belief, my personal belief. Now, that people say that's fiction. How can you believe in rubbish like that? Well, how's this for a bit of rubbish? You see a television program. Someone's dug up a femur and a few other scattered bones, and they put it in some kind of form, and then they build a program up. You see a dime store with the right amount of flesh, which a plasterer has put on there, built it up, the right amount of flesh on it. See, it's got a different colour, they know the colour of course, and then its mating habits and the way it lives its life. And we believe that straight away because it's science.
Who is your question addressed to?
You, sir. Science.
And what's the question?
We're supposed to... I can't make a choice because I believe in the Bible, because it also in Isaiah it talks about the world being a sphere before scientists believe that there's a flat world society in the 17th century. But we immediately... I mean, to believe in science, whereas a lot of it's conjecture. It's still Darwin's theory of evolution. It's not a fact. It's still a theory. It's called the theory of evolution.
Well, all scientific theories the difference between a theory and a fact is that the theory is the explanatory structure that brings the facts together into a coherent coherent system and a coherent framework, which makes the individual facts intelligible. So when people say, oh, well, it's not a fact, I mean, they're making a misleading contrast.
So what happens there? These
bones, because it's a theory. I mean, Newtonian physics is a theory. Theory there doesn't mean it's probably not true. Theory simply means it's a complex framework of hypotheses that explain the individual facts. Let me just make one other comment, if I may, sir, about what you were just saying. Because obviously, you know, what drives what you're saying and what drives what a lot of people are saying is the fear that if they go with the science, they're somehow being untrue to their religious convictions.
No fear, it's not true.
Well,
okay. Again, the danger of having a conversation.
One small little comment. Good science. I'm all in favour of good, testable and observable knowledge. Testable and observable knowledge is good science. If we can test and observe a guinea pig type thing turning into an elephant, or any genus turning into any other genus. Can you give me one example of one kind turning into any other? We don't talk about species, one genus, one kind. Then I would say, okay, that's observable, that's testable, that's good science.
What exactly are you asking for there, Dave? When you say, the answer is yes, there are millions of examples. Every species eventually turns into another species. What are you asking for? Are you asking for something in the fossil record?
Yes.
In the fossil record, you're not going to see something changing.
No, but there will be transitional links. There will be
The fossil record is absolutely full of transitional links. Don't forget that it's amazing that we have any fossils at all. Right? It's just a matter of chance that particular individual members of the species happen to fossilize in very, very specific conditions. So it's quite amazing that we have the number of transitional links that we do have. Now, just to take a classic example, one of the slides that I was going to show, people say, well, science has never found missing links. I mean, it's found masses of missing links. And a classic example is the fossil record of the early hominids. And originally it was just a hypothesis that the human species must have developed out of ape-like ancestors. Now lots of different early hominids have been found, Homo erectus, Homo habilis, and so on, which show amazingly what the different stages were in that process. Now, the problem is then, you know, every, as Dawkins, I think, has pointed out, every time the fossil record finds a transitional species, a transitional fossil, then the skeptics say, oh, that creates more gaps, because there are gaps on either side of the transitional species now. I mean, the fact is that, it's amazing that we have the fossil record that we have of transitional stages.
What more
could one want?
Okay. Interesting view. The paleontologists, the geologists are divided over this. You say that there are transitional, if there are many. Can you give me, there should be trillions, give me one. I'm not talking about within species. I'm talking about one kind changing into another kind.
Okay, last few questions.
Yes. Question for Rick. It's leaving like evolution stuff, it's beyond my ken. David. Let's take the traditional views that God created the universe, you know, ex nihilo.
Yeah. Ex nihilo, yeah.
Yeah, ex nihilo, out of nothing, yeah.
Yeah.
I was going to ask for context, but I'm going to ask a very simple question. How did he do it? And more important, him being perfect and not needing anything, being perfect, why did he do it? Why?
Good question.
Yeah, how do you do it?
Very specifically, the Bible is, it's not general, he's not the general creator. He's a very specific, articulate God. And he said he created everything ex nihilo, out of nothing, by his word. Let there be light. He gives a whole list of his little speeches where he proclaimed, by his word, he made everything, and that word became flesh.